Thank you for downloading this Council on Foreign Relations video. CFR is an independent national membership organization and nonpartisan research center. For more information, please visit us online at cfr.org.
Good morning. Delighted to see you all here this morning. My name is Camille Massey, and I'm Vice President of Membership, Fellowship, and Corporate Affairs here at the Council. And we have a lot to look forward to today. We have the convergence of two of the Council's important distinguished programs. We begin this morning with the McKinsey Executive Roundtable Series in International Economics. This is the fourth meeting of the series this year, and we are grateful for McKinsey's support at the leadership level in our corporate program and for supporting this series. We also have, and we're pleased to have, that this meeting is part of the continuation of the International Affairs Fellowship Program, the IAF. We kicked off the IAF conference last night with a conversation with a former IAF, Joan Spiro, in conversation with another former IAF, the current Deputy Secretary of State, Jim Steinberg. Many of you joined for that, and we're pleased that you're back today. And we hope that you will look to your left and look to your right and meet some of our former, current, and incoming International Affairs Fellows. So congratulations to the new class. There is a red dot on those who are connected with the program. It's been in existence over 40 years. And we also hope that you will linger, even if you just came for the morning's meeting, that you will consider staying and throughout the day. Where else can you start with a conversation about Euro at 10 and then move to U.S.-Japan relations and then look at the U.S.-India nuclear deal? And then we'll move on to looking at national security issues and U.S. foreign assistance and national security as it relates to climate change and the Arctic. So well, we have a lot to talk about today at 1 o'clock at lunch for the luncheon buffet, and hope you'll get a chance to meet each other. So with that, let me turn it over and to our presider, John Gapper, and thank you all. We look forward to the conversation this morning.
Thank you, Camille. As Camille mentioned, this meeting is part of the McKinsey Executive Roundtable Series in International Economics, and it's on the record. The next meeting in this series is going to be on May the 22nd, and it will have Alan Meltzer and Anne Kruger speaking. I have a fierce warning to you to turn off, not just set to vibrate or whatever, your cell phones and BlackBerries, because I think it interferes with the sound system. Welcome, everybody. We've got two distinguished and, I hope, and I believe, lively speakers this morning. You've got their details in the pack, so I won't go into it too much, but we have on my left, direct left, Jeffrey Frankel, the James Harpel Chair for Capital Formation and Growth at Harvard, and further to his left, figuratively speaking, James Grant, owner and editor of Grant's Interest Rate Observer. And we're going to discuss this morning the euro at 10. The euro was actually 10 in January this year, but like the European Central Bank, we decided to wait a bit before we did anything. I should note that, in fact, you will realize that the three people on the platform today, we have two people whose home currency is the dollar and one person whose home currency is sterling. So we don't actually have a direct euro representative, but I hope we will get one from the audience. And my only experience of a change of currency in my home country was in 1970 when the pound decimalized, so we went from 240 pennies to 100 pennies to the pound, which was traumatic enough at the time, but that's as far as we've gone. So I'd like to start by, I think we have the luxury, since we only have two speakers on the panel, of having short introductory remarks, actually, reflections on the euro, where we've got to and where we're going. And I'm going to start with Jim Grant.
Well, good morning, and thank you, John and McKinsey, and for all I know, the European Central Bank. The euro is a piece of paper of no intrinsic value that passes for money across a broad continent and indeed in much of the world. It is 10 years old and 5 months, so happy birthday, euro. It's not so much a success when you think about it as a miracle. That these 11 fractious countries would agree to suspend hostilities and to create a supranational currency is, when you think about it, improbable. At once the euro is monopoly money and confederate money, it is the emission of a supranational central bank designated as the continent's bank of issue, hence monopoly. And it is the emission of a confederation of states with no single exchequer, hence confederate. Confederate money does not connote intrinsic value here in the United States, but I guess in Europe it's a little bit different. Many doubted that this confection of the European elites would last as long as 6 or 8 weeks, and certainly it does not owe its remarkable longevity to its popularity. Starting in 2002, the European Commission polled what it sometimes patronizingly calls the people to ask what they thought of this project. Was the euro a good thing or a bad thing? They asked every autumn, beginning in 2002, those responding disadvantageous overall were 29% of the poll in 2002 and 38% in 2006. And then apparently the EC lost interest in the question. At least it stopped asking it. The euro is all very well in practice, but what is the theory? And perhaps we can get into that a little bit later. Price stability, why should prices be stable if the world supply curve is tipping prosperously downward and to the right? Why should prices not decline gently if hundreds of millions of willing hands are annexed into the world's labor force and if the cost of production is falling? Why should central banks stand against progress? Is one question Jeffrey is going to answer. I certainly can't. I wonder how people who transact in euros have marked this anniversary. Are they as sentimental about the lira and the pound, or the lira and the franc, and the pesetas as perhaps the New York City residents were about subway tokens? I don't know. I close in this half-hour preface with the proposition that monetary evolution actually goes in reverse, that we have evolved backwards from monetary regimes that were evolved and not made, the elegance and simplicity of the gold standard, for example, to the rule by mandarins that is the heart of the euro project. So that's my story, John, and I'm sticking to it.
We'll test that. Jeffrey?
I think that's the first time I've heard deflation described as progress, but with the 10th anniversary, of course, there's been a lot of taking stock. And Europeans in particular like to remind American economists in particular that most of us were skeptical about the euro ahead of time. And they love to quote Martin Feldstein as saying that the euro, if Europe went to full monetary union, this would cause a civil war, which isn't quite what he said. But it's true that a majority of American economists were skeptical. Looking back on it, I think there are some respects in which that skepticism was borne out and some respects in which it was proven false. And I've got a list of five on each case, which I'll try to go through pretty quickly. On the dimensions where it has been more successful than the skeptics said, number one, the transition for 11 fractious countries, as has been said, to a common currency is truly historic. It's never happened before. Except under conditions of conquest, something like that, major countries voluntarily giving up their currencies. And contrary to many people's predictions of just a few years before, it went through and went through smoothly. Number two, since then, five new members to the East have joined, and each of those have gone fairly smoothly. Now, we may be reaching the limit of that. It's not going to go so smoothly from here on out. But so far, they've all joined pretty smoothly. Number three, the euro instantly became the world's number two international currency, whether measured as reserve holdings or a currency in which to denominate bond issues and so far. Now, number two, well behind the dollar, as previously had been the yen and the mark. But I have a study with Menzi Chin, one version of which was published by Ben here, on looking statistically at what are the determinants of reserve currency holdings, and the size of the home country is an important one, which makes the euro a contender. But one of the really important ones is its ability to retain value. And the dollar's been losing value on a trend for 40 years. And according to our projections, the euro could well overtake the dollar as the number one international reserve currency by the year 2015 or 2022. These things don't happen very fast, but that's actually pretty fast now. It's not that far off, following in the path of pound sterling losing its place behind it. And Jim Grant objects to money as a monopoly and wants to see competition at the national level. Well, no country does that in modern times. But this is competition at the international level, which I guess you should like a little bit. The idea that there's an alternative to the dollar, if we abuse the exorbitant privilege and print too many of them and the value goes down, that then people can vote with their feet and switch to the euro. So that bit of it, at least, you should like. Number four, and this is one that actually surprised me. The officials of the European Central Bank, so far as I can tell, the members of the Monetary Policy Board, have voted as citizens of Europe, not as representatives of their home country. And that is really important. And I don't think I would have expected that ahead of time. Maybe the only European institution that works that way, but at least that's one. Number five, after a rocky start initially, the ECB has gained confidence and credibility. And closely associated with that, the euro has been a strong currency. So if you leave aside the first year and the last year, in between, it was appreciating rather strongly and still is quite high against the dollar in purchasing parity terms, or however you want to look at it. All right, next comes my list. At the same time, that the skeptics' warnings, and many of them very specific, have turned out to have had merit. Number one, shocks have hit asymmetrically. This was a big thing we were worried about. Originally, the idea was, you know, the Germanies would do well and the periphery countries would do badly. During most of the last 10 years, some of the periphery countries, Ireland being the best example, were booming and needed higher interest rates to rein in inflation. But they couldn't have it because they had to have the same interest rate as in Frankfurt. And not only did they get the inflation, they got the boom turned to a bubble, a property bubble like ours, which has collapsed like ours, and they're in a recession like ours, only worse. And probably that would not have happened if they had been able to choose their own monetary policy. So that's asymmetric shocks. Number two, if you're going to have asymmetric shocks and you don't have the freedom of your own monetary policy to respond, you need cushions to protect or insulate yourself against it. And labor mobility is the first line of defense, a private sector cushion. And Europe has less of it. There were some who predicted that Europe would be forced to move to increased labor mobility in response to the institutional constraints of the EMU, and I would say that has not happened. Neither flexibility within domestic national labor markets nor international labor mobility, maybe a little bit, but not enough. Third, as Jim said, the popularity of the project with the elites does not extend to the public. Every single time they're given an opportunity to vote on it, or even to vote on a question that sounds like it's related to it, they always vote no, which is, you know, rather, unless they keep asking over and over again, you know, and say, we're not going to let you go home until you vote the right way. And even then, it hasn't been on the euro. And many, many Europeans are completely convinced that when the euro became their currency, prices went up. And the statisticians usually say something different, but this is what most Europeans think. And it's a big issue, the democratic deficit. Because at some point, you're going to ask people to be making sacrifices for the sake of monetary union, to say, yes, we know we don't have the ideal monetary policy that is set in Frankfurt, but this is a project we all agreed to, and it's worth it in the longer term. It's a lot harder to make that argument if they never agreed to it, the publics. Fourth, the Stability and Growth Pact has proven unenforceable, which is what we all said, at least for the larger countries. They hit a budget deficit of 3% of GDP, they just blow right over it. And I think, you know, they've lost some credibility for their institutions more broadly. Related to that, and quite topical now, my fifth one is that keeping banking regulation at the national level, and of course fiscal policy at the national level, while monetary policy is centralized, is a kind of inherent conflict, which we wouldn't think would help anywhere, would work anywhere in the world, else in the world. You'd worry about countries getting into trouble and then needing to be bailed out. So far, it's worked, but now we may be seeing soon it's possible we'll see the real serious worries there when banks, you know, Austrian and Italian banks have lent a lot to Eastern Europe and they say, look, we need, it's a part of the whole system and we need to be bailed out. The last thing I want to talk about, so that's five and five. The last thing I want to talk about is a question that is sort of half and half, whether the euro would have a big effect promoting trade within Europe. It's all the statistical estimates, a lot of studies of this, and this is another thing I've worked on. Econometric estimates suggest that intra-Euro trade has been about 15% higher than it would otherwise be, controlling for lots of factors. Now, relative to what a lot of us thought 20 years ago, that's a big number. But many of us had our opinions changed completely by a very influential study of Andrew Rose 10 years ago on what had happened with previous monetary unions. And that was a huge effect. That was a tripling of trade. And nothing like that has happened. So I put that somewhere in between. It has been a benefit, and it's come without trade diversion. So it has, it's not just a fact, but a benefit. But on the other hand, it's nowhere near what we thought we might get based on the experience of other monetary unions among smaller countries.
Okay, thanks, gentlemen. we'll start with Jim. You referred to the euro as a confection, I think, but it sounds like it's a fairly solid sort of confection, a cake, perhaps. In that it's held together. Now, Jeffrey accused you of wanting to see monetary and currency competition. What's your real position?
Competition in money, I think, keeps the mandarins or the central bankers honest. And one can contrast institutions preceding the modern age, say, seeing the Bretton Woods age with those that followed the dissolution of Bretton Woods. And back in the day, let's take the Bank of France. The Bank of France was a commercial bank that happened to conduct a central banking business. It was in partnership with the public. It discounted the public's bills as well as the bills of commercial banks. It had branches throughout the country. It was at the beck and call of the public to the extent that anyone dissatisfied with the emissions of the Bank of France could present at the window of a nearby branch banknotes in exchange for which he or she would receive gold coins. And the Bank of France had cover against its paper of 70% in gold. And so the public was actually, the market was in charge. The Bank of France was famously passive. It would go for years, at one point, I think a decade, without changing its discount rate. And when the follies of Anglo-Saxon finance came front and center, one could count on the French for a thoroughgoing exoriation of these morons in the English-speaking countries. And one misses that now.
There's a little bit of that.
So before there was a dollar reserve currency, there was the sterling reserve currency. This was the paper money that was thrust down the throat of Great Britain's creditors, so to speak, John. It wasn't. And the French absorbed sterling balances under what was called the gold exchange standard. And finally, when the British went off gold in 1931, there was a great to-do in the Chamber of Deputies. Who was going to bear the loss from this devaluation? The Bank of France, the Treasury, who? And at one point during the debate, somebody gets up and says, and starts condemning the way that the Americans and the English conducted their monetary policy. And he said, this open market operations, there's not even a French translation of that phrase. So when we talk about competition, we're going to talk about not just the institutions that conduct monetary policy, but the ideas behind monetary policy. And I submit to you that there has been a gradual convergence of these ideas. And then really, it's quite homogeneous. And I think I see in Jean-Claude Trichet the distant echo of classical and solid French ideas about central banking hence his reluctance to act quickly, his seeming passivity in the face of macroeconomic necessity. I think these are the long distant echoes of a monetary regime that is now kind of archaeological interest or of antiquarian interest only, but I think that that regime is in fact what we need. We need much more of it. So, Jeffrey, in response to the question, or John's question of whether there's enough competition, no, there's not, and there's especially not enough debate about the intellectual underpinnings of money.
Jeffrey, do you think that we are moving towards a system in which the national members of the or representatives of the European Central Bank behave really no differently from the Federal Reserve Bank of St. Louis or Philadelphia or wherever, that they have a broad national interest or Eurozone interest at heart?
I do, and I think that's been, to me personally, the most surprising aspect. Now, every other institution in Europe doesn't work that way, and they like to have a common foreign policy, and they have all these institutions in Brussels, but it doesn't work that way at all. I do think the ECB does. Now, I don't know, there must be some cases of some representatives voting in the interests of their countries, but number one, I don't actually know of any. And number two, it does happen occasionally in the Fed as well. I mean, it's a district, if you have the Midwest and is having a hard time, they push for a discount rate cut, so there's a little bit of it there. But yes, I definitely think that. And plus, not just, it's a technocrat, quite competent bureaucracy. So I think that's, of course, not all bureaucracies are like that. And I think that's, and it's Euro, it's, they're Euros, they're citizens of Europe. So I think that's a quite a positive.
Competent problem. Bureaucracy.
You think it's a contradiction in terms?
I'm not saying it'd be a first. I'm just saying it's remarkable.
Well, small elite. Overall, central banks, I would say, are more likely to be more often, it's an empirical observation, competent than other bureaucracies.
How can you say that? I mean, we are sitting amid the ruins of this terrific explosion in every financial instrument, and these guys, these central bankers, had no clue it was coming, didn't know what to do about it when it arrived here, and now they are being presented with the brief of being the macro-prudential saviors. I mean, I think the whole thing is preposterous.
Well, I mean, I left myself open to that one. That's a good point.
Well, nobody's perfect, Jeff.
But no, nobody else. But nobody else saw it coming either. And Noriel Rubini's. Look, Noriel Rubini saw it coming, and maybe in your newsletter, I've had lots of specific things I said that to me sound very prophetic in retrospect.
I know, Jeff.
But in terms of the broad outline that we would have this complete freezing up of the most liquid money markets in the world, the interbank market in the U.S. and Britain. And did you forecast that? And I think by and large they're doing a pretty good job. But if I look for places to place blame, I think of regulation. The SEC was obviously mismade off completely, even though it was right in front of them. I think of Congress. The strong bias towards home ownership at all costs, get people into their own homes even if they don't have a prayer of affording them, unless prices continue to go up at double-digit rates. I can think of lots of places to place blame. And I do definitely on the list is I think monetary policy was too easy in the years 2004, 2005, 2006.
Well, let's just press on that point. There's an unlovely word which the Financial Times gets told off whenever it uses the pigs, meaning I think Portugal, Ireland, Greece, and Spain.
I wonder why.
The pigs are, as opposed to the BRIC countries, and the pigs were people who were a group of countries that were supposed to be about to default within the Eurozone. They haven't so far. The pigs have not been snorting or whatever pigs do. But due to this point, we've actually experienced an enormous monetary and financial shock within this rather young single currency zone. Do you think we're about to see more trouble, or do you think it's all going to hold together?
The difference between Ireland and Greece are at the opposite extremes geographically, and at the opposite extremes economically. Ireland accomplished a true economic miracle. I live in Boston, and for 100 years, the flow of Irish was from, it was into Boston, so there were more of them in Boston than there were in Dublin. And for 20 years, the flow was the other way. And the Irish economic miracle was a true thing, and it went on for 20 or 30 years. And then I think maybe the fact that it's now crashed severely, at least in part, it could be attributed to the fact that they weren't able to have to tighten monetary policy at a time when you were getting these bubble conditions. Greece is the one country that never really did what it was supposed to do. I mean, they sort of skated by. And so it's not surprising that they now have the highest, I believe they have the highest spread. So quite a range of experience. And I would say Portugal somewhere in between.
Jim, do you think the single currency will remain single?
No. I don't think this is destined to last for a very long time. I think I stand respectful and indeed awestruck at what it has achieved. It's no small thing. I mean, the progenitors of this project in the 50s with the iron and steel community, I think, were concerned principally, I think, about not having another continental war. The idea that Europe should somehow be destroying itself every 20 or 30 years was simply they wouldn't do it anymore. So this project, I think, was got its first push from the notion that we can do something, we intelligent human beings, can do something to institute peace on the continent of Europe. And you know, that certainly, there's been no gunfire at large scale for a long time. That's good.
Outside of the Balkans.
All right. And you know, as the ECB is fond of saying, in the last 10 years, 15 million new jobs in the continent, preceding 10 years, 5 million new jobs, and one, I dare say that Jeffrey has done studies that show how much of that can be controlled for other things than the currency. But the record on the whole with respect to employment, with respect to inflation, is kind of more than okay. Cynics, and I was certainly one of them at the start, thought that this conflation of fractious countries would succeed in nothing so much as debasement. And they never once hit the target, I think, over the 10 years. It was always a little bit off the 2%. This inflation was to be a little less, but not so much less than 2%. They never really got there. But really, as fiat currencies go, this thing has been a huge success. But I think there are centrifugal forces that, that although latent now, will become ever so apparent and manifest. And I, you know, as a truism of history, fiat currencies lose value and they eventually go to zero. And I think that must be especially true among in a supranational setting where there's no unifying nation state or treasury.
Well, that's an interesting debate. Then we've got Jeffrey saying it's going to become the reserve currency by 2020, and Jim saying it's going to go to zero. I mean, that's quite a contrast of views.
Notice I didn't say when. I'm not a child, John.
He means over the centuries. This is in the sense that every great empire eventually ended. You know, the Egyptians or something.
No. Every paper currency, if you lose 2.5% a year, in 10 years you're down a lot. In 50 years. You're wondering what your grandmother was thinking about when she was only paying 50 cents for lunch. I mean, these currencies lose value consecutively, and compound interest is a very powerful thing. So as a truism of compound interest, they go to zero. They go to zero. The pound sterling has essentially gone to zero from its purchasing power in September 1931. The dollar has essentially gone to zero when gold price was $20.67 an ounce. It converges on, doesn't quite. What's the mathematics? What's the function where you get close to the thing but don't actually get to it?
Right.
Asymptote. Right. So these currencies are asymptotes, and they do approach zero.
So in real, you're talking about in real value. At the end of that time, that's what you mean, in real value.
Yeah.
Well, but at the end of that time, it could still be the case that that currency is used for a thriving economy and everything's fine.
Everything isn't fine, Jeffrey.
You made it sound like it goes out of business. And I just want to point out that the scenario you're talking about is a scenario like the United States for the last 100 years, where we've become the largest economy in the world. But it's true that if you held...
Our currency notwithstanding.
If you held a dollar... Right. Well, I mean, so the currency has actually depreciated for 40 years, and that's what I'm worried about. But if we had had a rate of 2% or 3% inflation on average for 100 years, and so had the rest of the world... You would say the value of the currency has gone to zero. I would say it remains the premier currency for the most important.
Well, we are faced with this.
We'd both be right, Jeff.
Yeah, we would. We would.
We've got an unusual situation where I don't know if it's unusual. There's quite a few currencies you would think you would want to sell just at the moment, but you have to buy something.
No, we got to buy something.
And on the point of the reserve currency, I just want to test that a little bit more. The Are you convinced that the euro is going to be there strong enough and steady enough not to be overtaken by, I don't know, the renminbi or the whatever?
Well, I just want to answer that question in a second. I do want to flag something we just agreed on, that ahead of time, a lot of people thought you got the Deutschmark here with its history, and then you have, if you add the other 10 countries together, their economies cumulatively are larger, their populations are larger, and it's more likely that Deutschmark will be pulled down by the Italian lira than the other way around. And in fact, that did not happen so far, and that's a positive development. It's behaved quite a bit like a Deutschmark, and its value has been pretty strong. I want to stress that I recognize it's a minority position, and it's a pretty bold position to say that the euro might overtake the dollar over this. I'm not completely confident it would happen. It is what comes out of our econometric estimation, based on which is driven by what seems to determine the holdings of central banks over the last 50 years. How did the pound go through its final decline? How did the yen and the Deutsche Mark rise? And the variables that seem to matter with that. It's the depth of the home financial sector center. It's the size of the country, et cetera, et cetera. I'm not completely confident. But that's what that scenario says, the simulation. I mean, for 40 years from now, 50 years from now, it could be the renminbi. The sine qua non, which is, I like to use sine qua non if I'm talking about China, because it's a sinology kind of thing, you know. sine qua non of being a reserve currency is to have your home currency used, to have the currency used as the home currency and among a large set of people and in a large economy. And that's why, for example, the SDR, which the Chinese have recently been talking about, there was this speech by the People's Bank of China governor, Zhou Xiaochuan, saying that maybe the dollar should be replaced by the SDR. Well, if he's talking about it as a regular international currency, it's not practical. Nobody uses the SDR as their home currency. The IMF tried to do that, but it didn't work. It's just like Esperanto. Yes, it's a better language than English, but if nobody speaks it as their native language, it's just never going to catch on. You need this critical mass. So China's got that. What it's missing is open, deep, liquid financial markets. It's a long, long way from that. I mean, that's what's kept back, you know, the yen, for example. And that's why I don't think the renminbi could be an international currency of much importance at all. You know, maybe 20 years from now, it'll catch up with the Swiss franc. Possibly, if everything goes well, 40 years from now, it could be a contender.
Jim, any thoughts?
So back in the day, the legacy currencies of the euro had an 18% position as reserve currencies. That's the sum total of these 11, 18%. And then comes the euro 10 years ago, and it quickly gets to 25%. And now I think is at, what, 27 or so?
It's gradually rising.
Now, what the ECB never mentions much is the huge popularity of the ever-so-portable 500 euro note, which has made a big hit in certain lines of business, but may have been responsible in part for the initial surge of the euro's popularity outside the continent, conceivably. And the euro seems to have been rather stuck for some years at the 27 or 28% level of market share. My big thought on the dollar versus the euro is inertia. There is a huge inertial factor in these currencies. Habit is so important. The dollar is It's just the habitual invoicing currency of the world. It's what people use. They don't like it much. They don't like us sometimes much. But notwithstanding, the dollar has this pride of place and first mover value. And I think I know that within the documents of the euro, there is no contingency expressed for the dissolution of the currency. So if you were to take a big position in euro-denominated bonds and there are sudden rumblings from one of the pigs, or indeed one of the great and good countries, Germany is going to run, I read in the FT this morning, is going to run a 90 billion euro deficit, which is twice the unification deficit of 1996. So if you were, say, a Chinese asset manager and you owned, instead of $2 trillion, you owned a trillion or so euros, and there were rumblings within the eurozone that maybe we don't like this project so much anymore, how exactly would you get paid? And I think that not so implausible risk will be rather closer to the front than the back of the minds of the would-be accumulators of euros as the years go by. I think these centrifugal forces are important enough, if now latent, to stay the hand of would-be acquirers of euros in great size.
I'm going to ask one more question before we turn it over to the audience. But the sort of implicit suggestion of some of your remarks is that the good old French and Germans, with their sort of wish not to go to war and their terrible sense of responsibility compared with flighty countries like the UK, have kind of taken it on the chin for the rest of the Eurozone. And it's actually been good for the peripheral countries, and really the French and Germans haven't got much out of it. Is that true?
I mean, the answer to that question is varied. A few years ago, it looked like Britain was doing great, and Sweden and Norway were doing great, and let's go back 3 or 4 years ago, I'm talking about, and Germany was actually had been stagnating as badly and for as long as Japan, and so it seemed like a great thing to stay out, and the currency was strong, and they still had a budget surplus then, I think, you know, but that's all changed now, and Britain has taken some hard knocks. And of course, some of the countries that are on the periphery, we could see some real further shocks and severe developments coming from Central and Eastern Europe. But countries like Poland, have certainly gained enthusiasm for going in fast, it's getting the stability that the euro brings. So I got a mixed answer.
Okay, my final question is, I'm going to ask both of you guys, when is the right time for sterling to enter the euro? Jim looks shocked at that question.
The new Anglo-Saxon term that has no immediate French counterpart is quantitative easing. This is the otherwise known to the civilian population as really, really fast money printing. And it has suddenly become the big idea in central banking. The Swiss, of all people, have undertaken it. The Swiss have almost doubled the size of the Swiss National Bank's balance sheet in a year. And the Swiss keep on saying we want the currency to be cheaper, namely to say we want a brisker rate of debasement. Mervyn King in the Bank of England has embraced quantitative easing, and the Bank of England's balance sheet is up, I think, year over year, 116%. The Fed's balance sheet is up 143% year over year, and the ECB is most reluctantly undertaking to step up its rate of money printing. But again, Jean-Claude Trichet seems to have this Gallic little voice of conscience in the back of his head saying, don't do this. So what was the question, John?
Britain joining.
Yes.
Britain
don't.
Joining.
Don't.
No. Okay. Never. Okay. That's a good answer.
Yeah, unlikely. I mean, it looked different 10 years ago. And, of course, I mean, they came sort of close to considering it. And then Tony Blair, for God knows what reason, decided to follow us then to the swamps of Iraq, and then that was the end of that. I think not.
Okay. Well, I'm going to open it up to the audience now, and anybody can ask a question. Please just wait for the microphone to arrive. Say who you are and who you're affiliated with, if anybody, and just try to keep the question reasonably short. This lady here.
For a lot of ordinary Europeans, the euro's wonderful, especially if you travel from country to country, and they do, as compared to the way you people may or may not travel. But my question is, could you continue on sterling? The euro has affected rises and falls in sterling, and I'm wondering what you think the long-term impact would be, and on the Swiss franc. Sorry, my name is Evelyn Leopold, and I'm a journalist who had been with Reuters for 100 years.
I mean, the original goal, I think the vision of Jacques Delors, was precisely to be able to go from country to country, at least that's the way he talked about it, and without incurring these costs. And there was a statistic: if you start with one, you know, in Portugal, and you change your escudos into pesetas and your pesetas into francs, and by the time you're in, you really are left with nothing just because of the transactions cost. And I think this is a tremendous advantage, whether you're an American or a European traveling in Europe, makes things much easier. But I wasn't quite sure I got what your question was about. Can you rephrase it? Yeah. Well, I mean, in terms of this equation for reserve currency status, and by the way, Jim's quite completely right about the inertia, and I get a coefficient, a lag coefficient of more than 0.9, so it's just a little bit of adjustment per year, and that's precisely why the tipping point doesn't come until 2022, because it lags way behind the determinants. And sterling didn't give up its position until, depending on how you measure it, anywhere between 10 and 50 years after the U.S. had passed Britain by the relative criteria, because there is this lagged effect, and we use the money that everyone else uses, and so there's the inertia. But sterling actually, people hadn't noticed much, but had made a little bit of a recovery as an international reserve currency in recent years. But I think if my prediction is right about the euro, that's at the expense of sterling. The Swiss franc has sort of faded out. It used to be like number four.
I think the question really had to do with the cross rates and how the price of these currencies might be affected. I simply don't know. I guess insofar as the euro presents itself as a currency that will retain value that is much more liquid than the other two, it will present an exchange rate, a formidable exchange rate competition. But that is the blandest truism and not worthy of your question.
This gentleman here.
Eve Estelle Rothschilds. Let's grant, if you excuse the pun, let's grant that all fiat paper currencies have lost and will lose value over time. But the question that I have really is about the behavior of the euro and the pessimism that you have for it. I mean, if I look at the euro, I see more savings, at least of the constituent countries, for consumers than you would in the United States.
It's a pretty low bar.
It may be, but this is purely comparative, isn't it?
Yep.
I mean, it's not an absolute thing we're talking about. So really my question is, what would be the motive and the economic advantage for a country to try to leave the euro? I mean, Italy has thought about it, even has decided against it. What would be... Is it an economic force, or would it have to be a sort of political maelstrom that would cause it? How would you see advantage for anyone to leave and for the euro, therefore, to disappear?
Yeah, there's no advantage, but what was the advantage of going to war in August 1914? What's the advantage of the state of New York reimposing rent control in New York City? And a lot of humans do strange things which economists can't parse, and I think more in the predictable, cyclical irrationalities of the human race than I do in the continuous, cogent reasoning of those like you, Eve, who would argue for the stability of the euro based upon visible factors. I think something is going to happen in Europe that will splinter it. And, you know, we talked about the vision of Jacques Delors and about how you can move from country to country without these ruinous and annoying transaction costs. But, you know, before we had these, we had the universal currency called a gold, which is celebrating its 4 billionth birthday this year.
And what was the birthday of gold?
4.5 billion. Jeffrey, it's as old as dirt. So, you know, this is my assertion, which was unchallenged, I noticed, by the rationalist to my right, that monetary evolution goes in reverse. We get dumber in money as the years progress, not smarter.
Well, actually, I was very surprised to hear. By the way, I agree with not the last thing. I do agree that the short answer to your question is humans do all kinds of things. The more countries there are, the greater the chance that some populist country, there's some, you know, kind of civil war, you know, something happens somewhere. And so I do agree with that. But first, let me say that I find it unusual to attribute the good hard belief in the gold standard to the French when it was the British who introduced the gold made the gold standard the standard.
You're on dangerous ground when you're talking to an antiquarian, Jeffrey, about this stuff. Just know that.
Okay, I'm duly warned. Just to take the question at more narrow face value, even though I think it would be politics that would do it, and of course there are Italian politicians who have said it already, the Northern League politicians, but there would be such economic suicide that that it has been, you know, shouted down in Italy, because interest rates would go up instantly and they wouldn't solve anything. But the circumstance under which it would be economically something to talk about is where you're in one country is in a severe recession the other countries are not, and it just badly, and unemployment is very high, and social unrest, and people are demonstrating in the streets against the high interest rates and the tight money that are coming out of Frankfurt. And so that they even just economically, they find it in the advantage to drop out, which allows you to devalue, increase the money supply, and raise interest rates, three things you can't do. Having said that, I think the bar is so high, it would be so difficult to do that. There would have to be really severe to be in your economic interest. And if it were to happen, I think it would be the political angle that would do it.
Gentleman over there.
This wasn't intended to be, but I guess it's a follow-up of the question that was just asked. It's always seemed that one of the big vulnerabilities or problems within the structure of Europe and of the euro is the fact that fiscal policy is at the national level and there's asymmetry there. Could you continue your comment? As I've read more and more, it has seemed to me as though there are real strains now among the, forgive the term, pigs. And what happens if you begin to have, if you continue to have, let's say, Italy and Greece run really difficult fiscal policies while the rest of Europe tries to take a different course? And do those tensions, following the point that Jim has said, do those tensions begin to be hard to reconcile?
Handily, there's a way of quantifying how the world sees these tensions, and you can go on a Bloomberg screen and look at what is called the credit default swap quotations for these countries. Every country, every sovereign borrower is handicapped in the market as to the likelihood of default. And if you go back to the days of tranquility about 5 or 6 years ago, you find that the price you paid to insure, say, the sovereign debt of France was 4 cents on the dollar per year. Insignificant, or maybe anyway, it was. I've forgotten the grade.
But the spreads were basically. They were paying the same
for free. Yeah. And even France and Germany now have appreciably.
All basis points, I assume, rather than.
Have real risks of default assigned to them by this market, as does the United States Treasury, by the way. Although I'm not sure which counterparty you would take to insure against a Treasury default. But so these spreads blew out early this year, and the market was handicapping not only the possibility but the likelihood of a sovereign default. And I think, Jeffrey, this speaks to the headwinds perhaps that the euro might face as a reserve currency if even at one instance the market is in its fear was assigning such really high probabilities to a sovereign default. How do you then rationalize, or how do you explain to the Politburo if you're in China, or the Diet if you're in Japan, how do you explain your holdings of euro-denominated debt when you have to go to some workout conference and work out how many lira you're going to get, how many of the legacy currencies will now contribute to the workout? It would be a mess, and you would not advance your interest in your home country by doing so. I guess one can do worse than keep tabs on these odds based on CDS spreads.
Or just the regular sovereign spreads, which go back farther. Bo, I think you're right. This is a serious possible concern. Greece is the one that shut up by far more than the others, and for good reason. Now, I mean, when you go back to the beginning, People were sometimes a little puzzled, economists were, as to why you had the Maastricht criteria, severe constraints on fiscal policy and on debt, and then the Stability and Growth Pact, because it isn't part of the normal list in a textbook of conditions for a common currency. But the answer was to because there was this bailout risk, there was this moral hazard that if a single country, even though you wrote it, it's written completely into the law that they won't be bailed out into the treaty, Maastricht Treaty, that neither Brussels nor Frankfurt will bail out individual countries. But is that credible? And so this was the whole point of this was to prevent this from happening. Now it's a Stability and Growth Pact, you know, as I indicated, has not been enforced, and Greece, you know, it didn't help that the government, I guess he's. Is he out again now? The new government, when they came in, said the previous government had faked the numbers to get into the euro. You know that then on the budget deficit, that then reassure the rest of Europe the most. It had been said ahead of time. There was an argument that the states of Europe will be like the states of the United States, which is if one state of the United States, my home state of California, has got some problems now, and you start to have to pay more on an interest rate, like the credit default swaps, it shows up, and that sort of is one factor that keeps states from in addition to balanced budget amendments, keeps them from running up too big a debt. And so there was a prediction that the same thing would happen within Europe. And so even though the fiscal responsibility was at the state level and the monetary policy at the national level, that these interest rates would work. Well, until a couple years ago, they didn't work at all. They were flat. It was amazing that, I mean, Italy was the more obvious one for a long time, and then when Greece joined, that they didn't have to pay, contrary to before they joined, when they had to pay a premium for presumed default risk, after they joined, there was virtually no default premium. And I thought that was a little bit disturbing, because it couldn't be right. I mean, obviously, the chance of an eventual default in Italy, you know, creditworthiness was less than in Germany or something. And so it was a little worrisome that it didn't show up. I want to qualify my optimism here, but I do think it could be a positive sign that it's finally showing up. It shows that creditors are differentiating, mm-hmm. and it does provide a possible discipline mechanism for the countries that run up too large a debt. Nevertheless, the answer again to the question scenario, how it could fall apart, not an individual country withdrawing, but the whole thing falling apart, this is the way. And it could certainly come with one of the Eastern Europeans, you know, Central European countries that could come via that, either because they let them in a little prematurely, which so far they haven't done, or because you know, Austrian banks or so, Swedish banks are so heavily, let's say Austria, Sweden's not in yet, so heavily invested that it's a danger of bringing the whole thing down.
Okay. Brian O'Neill, I want to build on this last point that Beau raised and that you just touched on with regard to the possibility of the euro becoming a reserve currency, because central banks don't hold 500 euro
bonds.
They hold bonds.
Right, exactly.
And to the extent that there isn't a homogeneous bond, as there is, of course, in the case of the U.S. Treasury, I mean, and if the German bonds, of which presumably Germany's fiscal deficit isn't that large, as far as the eye can see, but if it has a very different credit spread than some of the other 15 countries. How real can that be, that a central bank, whether it's Russia, China, Brazil, can own that many bonds that have that kind of liquidity as an alternative to the U.S. Treasury?
No, it's an excellent question, and I couldn't quite get it into the equation. I mean, I try to get it in some ways, but basically the fact that although a lot of individual countries issue euro bonds, there's not one single big central liquid market in euro bonds could be the thing that prevents that simulation from coming true and prevents the euro from taking over. Now, I've even heard it suggested that maybe that means that Europe should move the fiscal function to the federal level and issue a federal bond. I mean, I would, if I were giving them advice, I don't think the benefits of being a reserve currency are all that great. They're not great enough to do that if you wouldn't otherwise want to do it. They've got to decide for themselves if there is sufficient popular support, democratic support, political support for moving the fiscal function to the federal level, which is a huge thing. I mean, it was a huge thing when we decided to do it in the U.S. Constitution, and it's not something to be done lightly, but it's an excellent point.
Over there.
Ryan Marshall with KKR. I just wanted to challenge a little bit this concept of that the euro has brought stability and tie it into the question of what is the breaking point from a socioeconomic standpoint if I've seen projections, Spain or Greece, Italy, Ireland going there, one of them is at 15% unemployment today, projected to go to 20. That's not a breaking point yet. I'm assuming 100% unemployment rate might be. but somewhere between those two points, we get to that tension. I'm curious to know, what do you think as a barometer a tolerance level would be? Or is there any precedent from a historical standpoint where we start to unwind at the socioeconomic level within a particular country who, unable, because of the stability of the currency system they're in, has to suffer a much higher unemployment rate, as an example, to make the correction to offset the subsidy that they've effectively received from an interest rate standpoint for the last 10 years?
Well, sure. There's plenty of historical precedent about countries choosing to change monetary regimes rather than suffer through a given slump. Just to pick some that come to mind. I mean, in September 1931, Britain left the gold standard without really protesting with a much higher bank rate. In times past, the Bank of England put up its bank rate to 10% or so to stanch the outflow of gold, and gold was flowing out in 1931, and Britain barely protested it, left the gold standard, and had a pretty mild depression.
And you think they should have? That was a mistake? Or?
I'm just giving the facts, Jeffrey.
Okay, I'm just trying to goad you into making an outrageous statement. Okay.
And the so-called gold block countries, on the contrary, had a more difficult depression because they hewed to the orthodoxy of the day, which is not actually the pure orthodoxy, but a gold exchange standard, which is a whole different subject for another day. Generally, I think countries are going to leave a monetary regime, and it's been demonstrated they will leave a monetary regime rather than suffer the torments of socially disturbing rates of unemployment. Spain is at 17%, and to be sure, the social safety nets in Europe are deeper than ours. But you know, this euro thing, Jeffrey, has been a success over 10 pretty tranquil years, and I say it hasn't really been tested through a full cycle yet. Now, we talk about the pigs, but Germany is an exporting country. It is looking at perhaps a 6.5% drop in real GDP. Now, that is truly comparable to the Great Depression. It's not there yet, but it's at least comparable in severity. You can begin talking about it without stretching. And you know, you have to wonder how this experiment, which is still an experiment, is going to hold up in the face of these truly scary tensions. And I'm much less confident than I think Jeffrey is as to the staying power of this project in the face of what might yet be much worse macroeconomic news than we have seen. It's been bad enough, but I think that you have to say that I guess Jeffrey might even say that the jury is out pending the completion of a full cycle. This is going to be some cycle. This is going to be some demonstrated cycle.
So a couple of points. I mean, these are severe strains, and we'll have to see how they come through it. And like I said, with so many Eastern European countries on the line to join, the odds that there wouldn't be any severe problems in any of them were always pretty low, or that this wouldn't present a challenge. And I have some of these worries. But the thing that has to be said is, and they make plenty of policy mistakes in Europe. Counterbalancing this is we've made some huge policy mistakes over the last 20 years, and we could well continue to make policy mistakes. So it's a question of who makes more mistakes, kind of like who, in terms of the attractiveness of the currencies. On the unemployment rate, I believe Spain has got the highest unemployment rate among the euro countries. I don't think, maybe someone who's more in touch with the situation, I don't think the Spaniards are demonstrating against, you know, it's the fault of people in Frankfurt. Now, maybe that would come. I've already mentioned Italy, but where is the unemployment rate at truly depression levels among EU countries? The Baltics, Latvia being the highest. That's literally at depression levels. What is it they want more than anything? To join the euro. To get that's what they see as a safety line that would get them out of this. And the IMF agrees with that.
Yes, so far, most of the political backlash seems to be on national governments rather than on the...
And you know what might make the euro, after all, an even greater success is say that this great recession ends sooner rather than later, and we've seen the worst of it, and the European Central Bank has, with characteristic French reluctance at overdoing it in money printing, has held back. And the Fed, which has expanded its balance sheet as if it were not in this hemisphere but another hemisphere, inflates the dollar to a fairly well. It might just be that the euro is the heir to the crown of stability. It might just be that after all of this, Trichet, who was the FT's man of the year in 2008, actually earns it.
Right up.
I'm probably worried a little bit more about the low national saving rate and the current account deficit being unsustainable than about the money creation per se. But that, yeah.
That lady there?
Elizabeth Bramwell. In the last 10 years, technology has changed a great deal. So I wonder if you could comment on the impact of dealing with multiple currencies if we go in that direction because of the enormous advances. You know, I think things like the SAP system, at least in terms of commerce, have made a huge difference. So maybe you could argue it both directions.
Elizabeth, the silence you hear is the silence of pure ignorance.
I mean, you're referring to the fact that transactions costs have gone, basically, the transactions costs have gone way down. Is that right? So therefore the volume of transactions have gone up.
Well, you know, I think you commented a bit on the fact that credit default swaps can actually have a real influence on what's happening. So, I mean, the speed of transactions, the speed of knowledge, the ability to convert exchange rates in real time has improved enormously.
I mean, it should be that improved efficiency in financial markets, both coming through from deregulation and competition and technology, all of which we've had, should make everything work better. And there were plenty of people who said that a few years ago. There were always, you know, some qualifications, and some of us had some qualifications to that all along. But now, you know, it's much more qualified. I think it's the picture is sort of mixed. So the credit default swaps, you know, I mean, usually this may be the first one of these meetings in a while where you've heard credit default swaps used in the context of, here's some useful piece of information that we can use to learn about something, which was the original idea about it, of course. Usually we hear about credit default swaps like, this is completely ridiculous, that the magnitude, the gross number that are written is vastly greater than the underlying security, and this is just a big casino and we don't need it. And I actually, I sort of think the good old-fashioned bond prices and sovereign spreads, which we always had, are perfect. We're a perfectly good way of getting the exact same information. I don't know if you agree with that.
Yeah.
So it's mixed. I mean, I think that as we all know, the integration and the size of international financial markets and the speed have been going up and up and up and up, and it's had effects both good and bad. I guess that's all I can say.
You don't have to answer, Jim. We can move on to the next question.
I think I've said enough.
We've got 5 minutes more to go, so we're going to have two or three more questions.
Thank you. Andreas Billmeyer with Ziff Brothers Investments. So far, I haven't heard too many Euro-Europeans speaking here, so
here's
the quota. Euro-European.
I'm sorry, I can't recognize the Euro-Europeans.
It's easier from the outside, let me tell you. I wanted to come back to something that you said, and you said it twice, so that's where I wanted to come back to, the expansion of central bank balance sheets. You quoted a few numbers, the Fed and a couple of other central banks. You did not quote the number of the ECB balance sheet expansion.
Well, yes, I did. It's up, and ever so modest as these things go these days, 33% year over year.
Are you sure about that?
Positive.
I'm not. I'm definitely not sure about 33%.
Well, there could be different measures. It could be different dates.
Well, no, let's get the last 4 reporting weeks measured over the previous 4. If it's not right, I'm going to fire somebody in my office.
All right. I'll look into it.
You think it's much bigger? Is that the point? You think it's much bigger?
Yeah. The point is essentially,
It had been. ECB was early in expanding its footings.
Exactly. And there you're coming to my second point, which is, again, something that you have argued sort of both ways. You're saying, Monsieur Trichet, oh la la, is a little bit late on doing some things. And yes, you may be right on the interest rate cutting. There's a question of where the bottom is in interest rates. Maybe the bottom in Europe is somewhere else than it is here. And second, the ECB would counter your argument by saying, well, but we have been much faster in expanding the type of collateral that we accept. So from a pure, once you say that the interest rate mechanism is broken, lowering interest rates doesn't have any effect, or very little. So the point that we made at the ECB, I mean, I'm not talking about myself, I'm talking about the ECB. Right. ECB made the point, look, what really matters now is get markets liquid and expand the acceptable collateral.
Right.
And that is where we are much faster than the Fed, would the ECB say. Could you comment on that, both of you, please? Thank you.
I think the facts you describe are exactly right. The ECB was much quicker off the mark in accepting collateral and in liquefying the banking system than was the Fed. The Fed persisted in saying, I think in literally these words, that the problem is contained. And it wasn't until, I think, the summer of August 2007, that the Fed actually, said, something is really wrong.
I think later than that. They were still saying it was contained in the fall.
Yeah, well, the first intimations of fear, I think, were the summer of 2007. I guess I was arguing both sides of it in this sense. I am a believer that present-day monetary arrangements are simply a huge disimprovement over preceding ones. I think that that the gold standard, in its simplicity, elegance, and in its popular support, was nonpareil. I think this was the peak in the efficiency of the monetary mechanism on planet Earth. And I think that movements away from it have been net negative. So, I look back a little bit nostalgically, I guess, on Trichet's remarks. I see them in the context of the French tradition of central banking, which is to be an entirely passive presence in the marketplace, not to lead the market, not to lead it, especially with open market operations, but to present a discount rate and to make the currency exchangeable into the statutory rate of gold bullion. That's it. That's it. And I think that those arrangements have not been improved upon. So I think that if you take the world as it is and not as I would prefer to revert, the ECB has been, quote, late. It has been late in responding. But I think that the instincts that made it late were the sound instincts. You don't want to stuff the monetary system with unwanted currency. You don't want to introduce this kind of moral hazard. I think that what the Fed is doing is, I think this quantitative easing is a terrible thing. And I think that the ECB, in its instincts, has been right in holding back from it. And it's not a very coherent message of mine, but that's what I was trying to say.
I mean, the gold standard. Maybe we should have a conversation with this about it afterwards. I could get a ride in your horse and buggy. Sorry.
your high speed train is lying at the side of the rails.
No, look. The gold standard was supposed to deliver price stability. Prices in the UK and the US swung plus or minus 20% decade to decade, and with the vagaries of world gold discoveries, depending on whether there had been any lately. In terms of popularity, it gave rise, the fact that there were no gold discoveries for 20 years in the 1870s and 1880s meant that monetary policy was very tight, and that's what gave rise to agrarian populism in the United States. William Jennings Bryan, we will not be crucified at a cross of gold. It was not very popular at that time.
How many times did he win the presidency?
winning the presidency is not always a test.
A popularity contest.
Yeah. Right, fair enough. That's one.
And on that note, I think I'm actually going to end since it's 9:10. Thank you very much for the panel. Extremely stimulating and wide-ranging conversation.
Thank you for watching this Council on Foreign Relations video. For additional audio, video, and transcripts of CFR meetings, as well as expert analysis of international news, please visit us online at cfr.org.